please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Good afternoon. Welcome. You're watching Your Stock Science Mera Abdi, and with me is my colleague Mangalam Malu. Hi, Mangalam. Good afternoon to you. But unfortunately for the market, it's taken a turn for the worse. So the Nifty is now at the low point of the day, down 0.6%. The Sensex has lost about 150-odd points. The mid-cap index, though faring a shade better actually than the Nifty, but still the index is down about 0.7%. Pretty much everything is taking some bit of a knock. So look at the likes of these OMCs. They were anyways down and out in trade. They have now extended their cut. So HPCL, which is reeling under its weak Q4 numbers, as well as this whole impact of the crude prices, that's leading losses with now an over 6% cut. Tata Steel is the other one that you should keep on your radar. In quick succession, that stock has lost about 2-odd% in total, losing seeing a cut of about 6-odd%. So that's the other big casualty. And of course, Vedanta has remained the talking point through the day and one of the big drags now in the index.
Absolutely, Sumaira. You spoke about a few stocks. A couple of these heavyweights, they too are dragging the index lower. Reliance, that one has slid a bit and that one's moved to the low point of the day, dragging the overall index below that 10,480 mark. So with this, the Nifty is now below the 100-day moving average. So we'll keep, rather the 50-day moving average. So we'll keep an eye out on that. The other one is ITC, which is now seen a cut of almost 2% from the highs and currently sitting with a cut of about 1.5% at the low point of the day. Would make sense to also pull up the advanced decline ratio or the advanced decline lines, because all through the day the green lines were above, the green line was above the red line, and now as we speak they have intersected. We have one stock in the red for one in the green. We'll keep an eye out on that. But first up, all the top stories that we're tracking. The market sees a sudden sharp fall. Just keep an eye out on the markets. We are seeing incremental cuts, and that is perhaps because of the European markets, which are trading at the low point of the day. Remember, yesterday we saw the Wall Street see a bit of declines owing to Trump's commentary coming in on the US-China trade war not ending. So we'll keep an eye out on that. The European markets are at the low point of the day as well. But we'll move on. Joining us today to answer all your stock queries, we have Vijay Chopra and Sandeep Wagle. And we'll go to the first one. Rhea Matthews, she writes to us from Ernakulam, wants to buy Firstsource solutions for the long term, wants to know the right time to enter the market. Well, Sandeep, your word on Firstsource solutions. Midcap IT has been doing fairly well. Do you think it's the right time for her to buy Firstsource solutions?
Afternoon, Mangalam. I would say she has to wait 63 to 57 in case it comes. That would be the right level for me to buy. I am commenting the stock from almost 46 to 48 levels, and my target was first 70, now it is 75 to 78. So if there is a correction and if she gets those levels, I would recommend her to buy with a stop loss of 50 and a target of 85 to 90 given a 12 to 15 month time horizon.
Vijay, I wanted to ask you this as well, because Firstsource declared its maiden dividend this quarter. You think it's a sign that things are on the mend, and it would be a good advice, therefore, for an investor to get in at these levels?
Well, I think that one should wait. And I agree with Sandeep when he says that, you know, around, say, maybe 62, 63 would be a good level to get into the stock, buy on dips. The dollar has been fairly strong, so all the exporters or all the IT companies should get a direct benefit of the same. Mm-hmm. So I think the company is doing good. My target for the stock is 80 rupees. So if at all Rhea gets it in the range of maybe around 62, 63, even, you know, up till 65, from 62 to 65 range, I think that she can get into the stock for a target of 80.
All right, so that's the word on Firstsource for the moment. Hold your horses. Up next, Sangram Kesari is on the line with us from Bengaluru. Hi, Sangram. How can we help you?
Hi, ma'am. Very good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
This is Sangram from Bangalore. Actually, I'm holding GSPL shares. Mm. Quantity is 22 and the average price is 222.
Okay.
So should I add for average or I'll wait for further correction? Actually, I was looking for top 5 to 10 stocks for next 10 years. So I took this one. You can tell me any other stocks also to jump for better profit for next 5 years. Or I would wait.
So basically a long, long-term view is what he has. Vijay, GSPL hasn't performed for a bit now. I mean, our caller seems to have bet on it for the next 5-10 year kind of a time horizon. What does one do? I mean, are there better bets out there, or will he gain by perhaps keeping the faith?
I think that if somebody wants to keep it for a longer term perspective, it would be a good idea if the stock comes around, say, maybe 150, 155 to average there and bring the average cost to maybe around 170, 175. I think that, you know, the stock has the potential of going up till 250. As you're saying that, you know, are there better bets around? I think that there are lots and lots of better bets. If you ask me in the oil and gas space, I think that there are several, Petronet LNG or even IGL, you know, buy in a correction for a longer term period. So these look good. OMCs particularly, you know, post the correction, I think that their valuations are becoming very attractive. So OMCs can be looked into with a longer term perspective. So there are options, but even in this stock, he can average and bring down his cost price, and he would get a profitable exit if he waits for some time.
All right, average and get a profitable exit later. Sangram, that's the word coming in from Vijay. Also believes that the oil marketing companies, they are attractive after the correction that we've seen. But let's move on. We have Yogesh Srivastav calling us from Uttar Pradesh with a query. Yogesh, go ahead.
Yes, sir. I'm holding 250 shares of Mahanagar Gas, 6 months before 930, average price. Mm. What is the perspective for 2 years, sir?
How long can you hold it for, Yogesh?
He's 6 months before I purchased.
Mm-hmm. And
but I have 2 year perspective area. 2 year.
Okay, 2 years from now, Deep, he's sitting on a bit of a loss. In fact, he's lost about 100-150 rupees from the buy price. From a 2 year perspective, or for a 2 year perspective, how does Mahanagar Gas look to you?
Well, Mangalam, I would say that if the trend is not in your favor, you should not hold on. I would recommend an exit or a sell off on any bounce back nearer to 840, 850. In case the stock breaks 770 levels, the stock can even go down to 700 levels. You should hold on only when you are in the money and the trend is in your favor. That is what I would suggest.
All right.
Still sitting around that 50-day moving average for the Nifty. The Bharti Airtel stock should come up for you. That one has slipped a bit. Was weak all through today's trading session, and now the weakness is just extended, currently sitting at the low point of the day. A lot of these banks have also come off the high point of the day. So the likes of Axis Bank, that one sitting closer to the lower end of today's trading range. And we've seen some cuts come by on a couple of these IT stocks as well, which have been otherwise doing fairly well. So the likes of Infosys should come up for you, which has lost a bit from the high point in today's trading session. That said, the rupee is still weak. The IT stocks are doing well. Infosys sitting just above that flat line. So we'll keep an eye out on individual stocks. But for that, we have Georgina Lobo. She writes to us from Mumbai, holds 2,000 shares of Lupin at 1,400 rupees for the last 4 years. A long-term investor wants to know whether to hold or sell. Vijay, a person's been holding a share for 4 years, is a long investor, pharmaceutical space, still losing half their capital. What would you say?
Well, I think that, you know, it's very painful to hold such a stock for such a long time, although Lupin, I believe, is one of the top-ranked companies in the pharma space. If she wants to stick on to Lupin, I think that, you know, averaging, it won't be a bad idea, around 700. So bringing down the cost price is something which is very sane at these levels. And I've been advocating and, you know, talking about it since almost what, a quarter or so, that the pharma industry is in the process of getting bottoming out. So there is a probability that, you know, we can see a very sharp bounce happening in the pharma space in the coming quarters. So average around 700 odd levels would be my recommendation. And I see Lupin reaching around, say, 900, 950, maybe by the end of the year. But again, reaching 1,400 would be a tough task in 1 year's time. Being the election year, I don't see such a jump that, you know, we'll see a 100% rise in the stock price. So averaging won't be a bad idea in Lupin.
All right, averaging a good idea at this point in time. Cheryl D'Souza now writes in from Mumbai. She says she holds 20 shares of NIIT. She was bought in about 8 months ago, and the level she bought in is at 117. So making just a tad bit of a loss at the moment. She's a short-term investor and needs advice on what she should do at the moment. Sandeep, what would be your thoughts? She's just making a tad bit of a loss, so I think it shouldn't be much of an issue at the moment.
Well, a bounce bounce back 21-22 is very much possible, but basically NIIT is not a strong stock, so nearer those levels I would recommend an exit. On the downside, stop loss would be 87, so I think exit would be a better option.
It would be a better option for NIIT Limited. Remember, the key play here is the holdings that it has in NIIT Technologies alongside the skills and education business that it has. But let's move on. We have Bajaj Electricals. Came out with a good set of numbers in this quarter. The EPC business was the one that performed really well, though the stock is buoyed lower by the fact that there was an exception which took the net profits lower. So we have Anant Bajaj, who's the MD of the company, joins us now. Anant, thanks a lot for joining in. And first up, congratulations on your promotion as the MD of the company. We'll start with your consumer business. EPC did fairly well. Consumer showed a growth of just about 5%, and this compares with a double-digit guidance that you had given. What can you say for FY19, and why the muted growth in consumer business?
Well, we have been, as we said for many quarters, we've been working on the TOC method of changing from push to pull method, and to that extent we had stopped all the primary deals, and to that extent it became much more of the distribution model, like which normally is there in FMCG model style, and that now has stabilized. And to that extent it was well known that the initially we will not have very high turnovers, but eventually it will catch up. And to that extent, it's what has exactly happened, that in the fourth quarter we did not get too much of traction, because a lot of the season actually, although it has started, but mm-hmm. the actual offtake did not start as early as we would have expected normally. And now at this current time also in April has been very strong, so which probably is purely to do with the little seasonal shift over and not so much to do with the actual demand. And we believe going forward for FY19, it should be a very strong year, because the remaining part of the country which had not completed TOC yet, that will also get done by September. Currently, we are covered already almost 488 districts. So about the remaining close to 160 districts which are pending, that also should be done in the coming months. And from our current approximately 160,000 outlets, it should go to level of 215,000 outlets. So there is clearly going to be a lot more traction in the market, because the reach has already happened. Now the actual demand will increase, because the availability has improved very dramatically.
Mr. Bajaj, good afternoon. What about the EPC business? This time around, we've seen a solid growth of about 40% plus. What's a sustainable growth rate here?
Well, as you know, we already have a very healthy order book. The key thing is to get good quality execution continuously. And so I can't put a specific number what would be the healthy growth, because as business, I think there's nothing which can be healthy enough. There's always something better. And so from that standpoint, I think it's the key thing is to get very high quality product with good, correct execution done on timely basis. And with our couple of those big UP projects which we have got, it is all about precision and perfect working style that completes the execution correctly. And that's exactly what we have been doing, and I think that's where the real opportunity is also there for that EPC industry, which we are already part of.
Right, Anant, you know, this is with regards to the exceptional loss of 89 crores on your books. We understand that this is because you've reassessed your recoverability in one of the investments and the loans provided to Starlight Lighting. Is there any more, or you've recognized all of it, 89 crores?
Yes. Yeah, this is pretty much the whole thing, because I mean, obviously it came as a very big surprise, to the extent that with our new NDS rules, and I think overall also it was important as a company to take the right call. I mean, because this was something which we were really not aware there was such a big gap, and when we put the new auditors into checking the detail, it really got us the full picture. And end of the day, as a company, I think we've always believed in doing the right thing, and that's what we exactly did. That it was essentially I mean, the larger issue was that the CFL was what we had invested originally in, and which did not work out. As you know, the industry till 2013 was going pretty well, and then it really tanked as a product. And then when we really put, more products in, but the key investment was in the CFL, and which as a product really kind of quickly disappeared from the market portfolio. So going forward with LED, water heater, air conditioning for a couple of brands which we do, plus the mixer, there should be a good portfolio which will take care of the stability of that portfolio out there. And going forward, we don't see any further impact from Starlight.
Will you be exiting the CFL business?
I mean, in time, yes, because it's already, I mean, the writing is clearly on the wall that CFL as a product is right. Not going to survive for 2 months longer. Even if you see our numbers over the last 3 years, it has been dipping quite dramatically the total industry. And to that extent, we can't really give you the exact timeline, but soon enough, it is going to be an exit from that portfolio of CFL.
All right. Anand, you know, you sound pretty sanguine about your consumer business. You've had a new distribution plan. You have a good product mix as well. You're also pretty sanguine about the EPC business growth. In that case, we've asked this to you before. Any plans of demerger between the two? Value unlocking happening, perhaps consumer durable stocks are doing fairly well. There is focus on EPC as well. Maybe give investors a chance to, you know, play both these themes separately.
No, there's no reason. In fact, now it's even stronger reason not to demerge, because if you see, we literally, at least in Indian condition, and if you put it in a global condition, there's almost no other company which has B2C and B2B in the same space. And reality is, imagine if this was only consumer products company. I mean, it would have been very difficult for the whole process to be followed, because the B2B part did really well to take care of the shortcomings of B2C while they were implementing the TOC basis. Now that both of them are going to be stabilized, there should be really no reason to demerge. And frankly, if you do good, and it's largely because a certain industry gets certain perception, is why you believe that it's not good enough. But if collectively Bajaj Electricals is a strong company and gives you the delivers the numbers which we talk about,
right,
I don't see why we should not do good for the investors.
Mr. Bajaj, appreciate your time. Thanks very much. All the very best for FY19. Also, keep your eye on the market. Once again, back to the low point of the day. The Nifty, in fact, heading to the 10,460-odd mark. The Sensex has now extended its cut to about 170 points. HPCL down 8%, Tata Steel down 6%, and a whole host of other stocks as well. Your stocks, keep your eye on the market. Bit of pain coming through. And also look at IDBI, for instance. That stock seems to be doing well. But otherwise, from the frontline space, not too much action being seen. SBI, though, continuing with strength, about 4% higher at the moment. With that, we'll wrap up on your stocks. Do stay tuned. Closing bell will carry on the market action.